Tread with care, Captain. You come in dangerously close to accusing the head of the Cardassian government of attempted murder.
Is that what I'm doing?
Oh, how delightful. The mysterious plots, the subtle innuendo, the veiled threats, it's also entertaining.
The television and film universe is overflowing with villains. As a result, we've got a few good villains out there.
I'm not Scorpius, but he is.
But also a lot of bad ones.
No!
Possibly as a result of this saturation of general villainy, there seems to be little agreement in the film and television world on what constitutes a good or even a great villain.
Did you know her?
No, huh? Oh, wait. Was she a great big fat person?
Despite this lack of consensus, we would suggest there are certain qualities that can turn a mediocre agitator into a good bad guy.
Hello? I've just shot somebody! I did it on purpose!
Villains are antagonists, adversaries, opponents.
You don't know what you're talking about, do you?
Sir?
Generally speaking, the villain is a kind of moving obstacle that the story's hero must overcome. But is just being an obstacle for the good guy to outsmart the best component of being a great villain? It turns out, no. There are other more crucial ingredients that need to be considered.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
For starters, a villain can also be a foil. That is, a character which is similar enough to the protagonist, but that also possesses key differences that serve to highlight, through contrast, the more positive characteristics of the hero. For example, Draco Malfoy can be considered a foil of Harry Potter. They are both young male wizarding students, both play as seekers for the respective House Quidditch teams, and both are people of some influence at Hogwarts.
Is this yours?
Draco, however, is elitist, egocentric, and a bit cowardly, where Harry is more egalitarian, altruistic, and courageous.
Wait until my father hears that Dumbledore's got this oaf teaching classes.
Shut up, Malfoy.
Another crucial ingredient to good villainy is this.
I think every villain is a hero in his own mind.
That's right. A great villain is the hero of his or her own story. They believe that they are making good decisions to either better themselves or better their world. This connects with audiences because none of us out here in the real world generally think of our decisions as bad ones. We make choices based on the circumstances surrounding us and justify those decisions according to our worldview. Watching a villain do the same adds dimension to the character, making them potentially more relatable and realistic.
You can bring your urgent matter to me. Your king.
Which leads us to the third crucial element of great villainy, choosing a false or damaged philosophy or worldview. The best villains aren't just evil for the sake of being evil. Instead, they are motivated by how they see the world. And the more relatable the villain's philosophy is to the viewer, the larger the potential for villain greatness. As an example, let's consider one of the most iconic villains of all time, Anakin Skywalker as Darth Vader. Anakin, who is deeply hurt by the death of his mother, finds his fear of losing his wife Padme is accentuated by visions. Yoda advises Anakin to let go. However, when Senator Palpatine offers Padme salvation through embracing the dark side of the Force,
learn to know the dark side of the Force, and you will be able to save your wife from certain death.
Anakin eventually chooses the latter. As someone who intimately understands loss, Anakin could not let his wife go so easily. He chooses the wrong philosophy as his worldview in order to save a loved one. It is a choice that many of us would struggle with, which makes Darth Vader all the more relatable. And it is Darth Vader's relatability, in part, that makes him a great villain. Now that we've identified these villainous elements, how does this all translate to Star Trek? Consider, if you will.
I don't understand. You're a Cardassian.
I'm not just any Cardassian. I'm Gul Dukat, commander of the Second Order. You have 15 seconds to lower your shields or we'll destroy you.
No, wait!
10 seconds.
No, it's not that simple!
7 seconds.
I've already been paid!
4 seconds.
Stop counting! Stop counting!
He's lowering his shields.
Gul Dukat, portrayed to excellence by the wonderful performances of Mark Olaimo.
I think you can handle it from here.
Warning, there are some serious spoilers ahead. Dukat is, in my estimation, probably the greatest Trek villain in the entire franchise. For those of you who might not know, he is a prominent Cardassian military officer who served as the prefect of Bajor during that planet's occupation by the Cardassian Empire. He is charming, confident, ambitious, judiciously merciful, and at times unpredictable and ruthless. A casual conversation between Gul Dukat and Niccolo Machiavelli about power and politics might have been a beautiful thing to behold.
A true victory is to make your enemies see they were wrong to oppose you in the first place. To force them to acknowledge your greatness.
Over the course of 7 years of Deep Space Nine, we get to know Dukat very well. And we sometimes perceive him as a potentially redeemable character.
This isn't funny.
It is from this angle.
Self-image is very important to him, but he also displays moments of empathy.
You could have left me behind. Why didn't you?
I didn't want to.
And then, just as soon, that empathy evaporates and the depth of his manipulations become apparent.
Was it necessary?
You're the terrorist. You tell me.
So let's consider Dukat as a great villain. Is Dukat the foil of anyone in particular? Does he see himself as the hero of his own story? And what is his worldview or philosophy?
This is a very entertaining story, but why am I listening to it?
It is safe to say that Captain Benjamin Sisko is the hero of Deep Space Nine, and Gul Dukat is Benjamin's foil. Remember that foils have to be similar to the hero in some way, yes? Well, both Dukat and Sisko are career military commanders. Both of them are family men who love their children greatly. They are both people who understand personal tragedy, which causes each to lose their way a bit. Both men are connected to the Bajoran people in a profound way. Sisko, as the emissary to the prophets, and Dukat, as the former prefect of the Bajoran occupation. And, even though both men reject the basic premise of the Bajoran religion, they are both, in turn, pulled into the conflict between the prophets and the Paw race. They've even separately used the same office.
Excuse my presumption. This was my office only 2 weeks ago.
These similarities only serve to highlight the differences between both men in classic foil fashion. As commander, Sisko leads his team through open collaboration and respects the opinions and beliefs of others. On the other hand, Dukat and the entire Cardassian military rely on pride for and fear of the Cardassian state to keep subordinates in line. In terms of their respective Bajoran positions as emissary and as prefect, Sisko works to enable Bajor to make its own choices, where Dukat feels subjugation within the Cardassian Order is the only real compassionate option for the Bajorans.
I believe that in some ways the occupation actually helped Bajor.
Which part? The massacres or the strip mining?
And while Sisko famously tries to manipulate the Romulan government in order to drag them into the Dominion-Federation War, perhaps a practical Dukat-style gamble, he did so under the larger pretense of keeping the Alpha Quadrant free. Dukat, on the other hand, has manipulated his way around several governments, and usually in order to position Cardassia and himself on top of the galacto-political order.
This is the fourth assassination attempt I've survived.
Maybe you should find another job.
So, does Dukat view himself as a good person, as the hero of his own story?
You know, Dukat, I thought you'd changed in the last 5 years. I see I was wrong.
One man's villain is another man's hero.
Captain?
Dukat's motivations can change pretty quickly, as he needs them to, but it is clear that he feels he is the hero of his own story, that he is, in his own way, trying to make the galaxy a better place. Dukat attributes various heroic and good-natured qualities to himself, and in true Dukat style, he will tell you about them.
Maybe I am seeking to regain my former position, one which I earned through hard work, dedication, and sacrifice.
Part of that heroic set of qualities involves a fair amount of patriotism and running into battle when necessary. Dukat may be a lot of things. Brave is certainly one of them.
Don't you see, Major? I am the only Cardassian left. And if no one else will stand against the Klingons, I will.
Dukat also feels that he is a very just and fair-minded person, and seemingly will admit when he's made mistakes, although there is always a caveat.
I compromised myself and have been punished accordingly. Besides, everything I have lost, I will regain.
Gul Dukat can go to great lengths to qualify his actions. However, it might be that even Dukat is unaware of how far-reaching the scope of those justifications have to be.
So that means that you are responsible for the murder of over 5 million Bajorans on your watch. True or false?
False! I tried to save lives during my administration.
Increasingly, his resolve to justify himself to others is slowly worn down, especially as other principal characters get to know him and his methods.
You can justify yourself later, Dukat. I'm a busy man.
Very well.
And then, as a result of the death of his daughter Zial, he cracks, and his desire to justify himself is torn completely away with his sanity. All that remains is a more truthful, more unpredictable, more dangerous Dukat.
I knew it! I've always known it! I should have killed every last one of them! I should have turned their planet into a graveyard the likes of which the galaxy had never seen!
Which leads us to the worldview or philosophy behind Dukat's motivations.
I should have killed them all.
Cardassia will be made whole. All that we have lost will be ours again. And anyone who stands in our way will be destroyed.
Do you see how Dukat couches his explanations in terms of patriotism? Even though it's obvious that some aspect of his decisions are designed to keep himself in power, Dukat always felt like he was doing the right thing because he based his system of morality on the Cardassian spectrum of right and wrong, which is supported strongly by the Cardassian state. The mentality of that state is a combination of old-school European colonialistic attitudes and classic racism, like a reading of Rudyard Kipling's The White Man's Burden.
From the moment we arrived on Bajor, it was clear that we were the superior race, but they couldn't accept that.
The Cardassian state is superior and always right, and feels compelled to explain its disposition to outsiders. That sense of superiority filters down to the individual.
Isn't there ever a chance you might try an innocent man by mistake?
Cardassians don't make mistakes.
This Cardassian sense of righteousness demands blind patriotism from its citizens, and Dukat typifies that patriotism. Concerning the Bajoran occupation, Dukat really felt like he was bettering lives, and this is because Cardassia felt it was doing the right thing for the Bajorans.
We did not choose to be the superior race. Fate handed us that role. And it would have been so much easier on everyone if the Bajorans had simply accepted their role.
Cardassia always aspires to greatness and enjoys viewing itself as a galactic culture of influence. And as an agent of that aspiration, Dukat always gambles big. He helps to conduct coups. He goes rogue against the invading Klingons. He courts the Dominion in a bid to rule the entire Alpha Quadrant. And finally, Dukat tempts fate by aligning himself with the Pares. Dukat's decisions are high stakes. He always reaches for a greater position of power. Through understanding the Cardassian cultural mindset, maybe we can see some of the reasoning behind Dukat's actions. Star Trek's huge cast of villains leaves a lot to be desired. And although there are certainly a few gems here and there, Gul Dukat's depth of character is unmatched in the Star Trek multiverse. He truly is one of Trek's great bad guys.
This I vow with my life's blood. For my son, for all our sons.
Thank you for watching. Please feel free to leave a comment in the subspace below and click on over to Patreon to support the channel. Thank you.